Thank you, Kate, and welcome to Inside Politics. I'm John King. Thank you for sharing your day with us. The president on the move this hour in Florida for a roundtable on taxes. But with so much controversy swirling, here's a question. Will the president stick to the script? Plus, his longtime personal lawyer is due in court shortly. And porn actress Stormy Daniels also showing up. Yes, a bit of a circus, but also big legal questions as a rattled president tries to find out just what prosecutors know. And a new tweet storm attacking James Comey, the former FBI director, looms large in the other big investigation threatening the president.
At least in my experience, he won't criticize Vladimir Putin, even in private. Even in a meeting with three people in the Oval Office, he is arguing that he gave a good answer when he said, essentially, we are the same kind of killers that Putin's thugs are. And that struck me.
To Director Comey, the debate over his publicity blitz in a moment, but we begin with today's escalation of a court fight that is full of tabloid and reality TV flavor, but also holds enormous consequence for President Trump and his longtime fixer, Attorney Michael Cohen. Cohen is due in court this afternoon, and a short time ago suggested in a new legal filing that the investigation of his business dealings is politically motivated. It is worth noting, very important, federal prosecutors in New York who served the sweeping search warrant on Cohen last week work for the Trump Justice Department. But, like his client, the president, Cohen asserts in a new filing there is growing public debate about whether criminal and congressional investigations by the government are being undertaken impartially, free of political bias or partisan motivation. Now, that filing challenges the search warrant and says if the court won't just throw it out, it should at least create a special process to review the seized materials, that designed to keep privileged information away from prosecutors. The hearing gets underway in 2 hours, and the porn actress Stormy Daniels plans to be there, too. The seized materials include evidence about Cohen's payments to Daniels, who says she had an affair with the president. Also there will be a new legal team hired by President Trump, who wants to know just what the feds know about Cohen. CNN Crime and Justice reporter Shimon Prokopez will be heading to that hearing shortly. Shimon, we're learning more and more about the government's investigation. Tell us.
Yeah, that's right. So this morning, the court filed a transcript from Friday. There was a transcript that it was a conversation that occurred on sidebar. And this morning, the court released that. And what we've learned is pretty significant here in terms of just where the investigation stands against Michael Cohen. The prosecutor, the lead prosecutor in this case, talking to the judge at the sidebar conversation, says that they have considerable amount of information about Mr. Cohen's activities. He then goes on to say how this is a fast-moving investigation. Essentially, what's going on is the government feels that with these emergency relief requests, with what Michael Cohen's attorneys are doing, and now what the president's attorneys are doing, is just a stall tactic, and they're hoping to just get going. They want to be able to start and continue their investigation, start looking at the material that they seized on Monday. They have not been able to look at any of that. But keep in mind, even before this raid on Monday, what they're saying is that they already have considerable amount of information. And we also know from Friday's filing, another filing that they that was posted on Friday, that his emails, Michael Cohen's emails, are in the possession of the government, that they had warrants for it, what they called covert warrants, and they've been able to review that. And it's essentially what's at stake here now, John, is, like you said, whether or not the government is going to be able to proceed in reviewing these materials. It's likely the judge will rule today. She says the case law is really on the government side, not on the defense team side in this one.
A remarkable hearing coming up just a couple of hours. Shimon will touch base with you tomorrow, I'm sure, about the details of what happens inside the court. Appreciate the reporting there. With me today to share their reporting and their insights, Julie Hirschfeld Davis of the New York Times, CNN's Manu Raju, Catherine Lucy of the Associated Press, and Mary Catherine Hamm with The Federalist. Again, like everything involving the Trump administration, there's some reality TV aspect to this, the porn actors showing up for the court hearing. Let's set that aside for a minute. The president's personal attorney, in language much more tame than the president, but picking up the president's argument, trying to suggest this is politics at play here. The government saying, no, we understand it's a high bar to have a search warrant served on the president's personal lawyer, on any lawyer, but especially the president's personal lawyer. But we have evidence that we think he's going to destroy evidence. We have evidence that we have a case against him. We're going to get to Jim Comey and Robert Mueller and the Russia special counsel in a minute. Inside the White House, they think this is the biggest immediate threat to the president of the United States, right?
Well, certainly the president thinks that it's the biggest immediate threat to him. I'm not sure that his entire legal team shares that view, but what Michael Cohen knows and what is in his records likely is a lot of things about Donald Trump's business life, his personal life, things that go way beyond just the period when he was running for president and now that he's been in the Oval Office. And the president views that as an existential threat. If someone can get their hands on all of those private matters and the details of all those private matters, that is going to be a problem for him, he believes. And so I think that's why his staff is operating on that assumption, because whether or not the stakes of the Russia investigation are higher, sort of empirically speaking, the president sees this as a direct attack on his authority and on, you know, his sort of right to privacy and to keeping all of these things. And there were a lot of issues that Michael Cohen dealt with for Donald Trump, private.
I mean, think about the bizarre nature of the hearing. There will be three parties in there arguing they have privacy rights here: the president of the United States, the president's personal attorney, and a porn actress.
And the big issue, I think, that, to Julie's point, that the president's team, they're trying to figure out is just what exactly they have. And that's creating a lot of anxiety because there's a lot of uncertainty about just how much information there is and what could be in there.
I think you just take a step back to see how much potential legal jeopardy the president is in right now. I mean, not just on this case and with Michael Cohen or whatever they have seized in this raid that could potentially implicate the president one way or the other, the Mueller investigation still picking up steam. There could be other associates to the president who get into further legal jeopardy. And then on the civil side, the Stormy Daniels case that, you know, Michael Avenatti, the attorney for Stormy Daniels, is pursuing. What if the president is forced to be deposed in that case? The president is being hit on several different fronts now, which perhaps is one reason why he's lashing out in different ways. But it's remarkable to see a president under siege in so many different fronts on the legal side.
And it's going to be fascinating, I think, today to hear the prosecutors make more of their case, in the sense that whatever you think of the president of the United States, he has the right to legal counsel. Whatever you think of the president of the United States, he has the right to have private conversations with his attorney. What the government is saying is that's not what this is. That if Cohen is in the process of either covering up crimes or illegally moving money around, that's not covered by the attorney-client privilege. But the president's legal team filed this late last night. The president objects to the government's proposal. Fairness and justice, as well as the appearance of fairness and justice, require that before they are turned over to the investigative team, the seized materials relating to the president must be reviewed by the only person who is truly motivated to ensure that the privilege is properly invoked and applied, the privilege holder himself, the president. They're making the case that we should get the materials first, and then here's the prosecutor will argue back, we can't trust him to only hand over the stuff that's not covered.
Well, and there is a process in place by which you clear those, but it does go through the law enforcement agency, right. And I can understand them being concerned about it. I will say also, Stormy's team remains extremely good at playing this game, right, by putting her in that courtroom for the hearing, and it's a Trumpian-style game to keep people paying attention, and perhaps one of the reasons that he's paying a lot of attention to it, because this is his turf. This is his media-style war that she's waging, and waging it successfully. But from a civil liberty perspective, even if you don't care for Cohen or you don't care for Trump, I don't mind the government being put through its paces on this one bit. And there are plenty of civil libertarians who would have agreed with you more perhaps during the Obama years, including at the New York Times editorial page that sort of shrugged this off the other day. But it's important for them to bring the reason that they went to this extraordinary place.
I agree 10,000% in the sense that if the government, this is unprecedented. It's very rare to serve a search warrant on an attorney. Unprecedented, Michael Cohen argues, and I can't think of another example, to serve on the personal attorney to the President of the United States. So they should be held to a high bar. The question is, if they clear that bar, what does that say about Michael Cohen and potentially about the president? To your point about Stormy Daniels playing Trump's game, if you will, and understanding the media, this is Michael Avenatti, who is her new attorney, who gets this business very well. This is a tweet from him: to those who do not learn history, those who do not learn history are doomed to repeat it. And then tweets a link to a 1991 story in the New York Times where one of John Gotti's aides, mob boss John Gotti's aides, turned on him. You could argue that's reckless. You could argue that's unfair. You could argue it's putting the cart way out ahead of the horse in terms of what we know about the facts. You could also argue it's pretty clever.
Well, absolutely. And I mean, what was interesting about that statement you just read from the president's personal attorneys is that he talks about Donald Trump being the only person who can review these materials and say whether privilege needs to be invoked or not. Well, you'd think maybe Michael Cohen, who is the actual lawyer, would also be one of those people. But what's interesting to me about the way that they worded that is that there is the possibility that Cohen could flip, and that's clearly what Avenatti is trying to suggest. I think, you know, Trump thinks that he's going to be loyal. He has been loyal. Cohen has been trying to telegraph that he will continue to be loyal. But the fact is, the legal stakes for him are huge, and there is the possibility that he could be motivated to, you know, tell prosecutors something that they need to hear or want to hear about the president in the course of dealing with all of this legal risk on him. And so that's a real concern for the president. That's another of the reasons that he is so worried about Cohen being targeted in this way.
And I think it's fascinating when you hear from Shimon at the top of the show about the sidebar. And if you watch court TV, you know what we're talking about. The judge calls the attorneys up to talk over here. It's hard to hear them in the courtroom. That transcript, the attorney's making the case, you can't stop us here. We need to see these materials as quickly as possible because they say, and they should have to air it out in court to the degree they can without compromising the investigation, they say they have evidence that Michael Cohen was not acting as an attorney. He's in some sort of corrupt business practices. And that the reason they served the search warrant and didn't just hand him a subpoena is because they had evidence to believe, and that's a high bar to cross, evidence to believe he was going to destroy evidence or not cooperate with their investigation.
Well, and it is notable to me that in all the news coverage now about Cohen, increasingly the first word that's used to describe him isn't attorney, but is fixer. I mean, this is the president's personal attorney for the president, but the thing that we hear the most about is that he is somebody who fixed things for him, legally, privately, however he did it. And I think that is really what they're trying to get at here.
But just given how extraordinary this is, that, as you mentioned, very rare for an attorney for this to happen, perhaps unprecedented for the president's attorney. Clearly they had a significant degree of evidence to go forward and get a judge to allow them to search these premises. So they probably have some rationale for their argument going forward. It just, we'll see what the judge ultimately says.
And just like in the special counsel case, a lot of it's cloaked in secrecy, a lot of it's cloaked in privilege and privacy. We've learned little nuggets from these court hearings. When people go to court, Manafort case, for example, to challenge. That's when we learn about it. We're going to learn more this afternoon as Michael Cohen and the president's team challenge this warrant. Up next, James Comey's Media Blitz begins. He's certainly selling books, but is he undermining his credibility as a witness? Welcome back. You know this unless you've been hiding, but James Comey kicking off his tell-all book tour with a very controversial bang. You've already read the excerpts or seen him on television. He takes shots at the president's appearance and his moral character. Now, in an interview with ABC on Sunday night, Comey going for the jugular. Remember what matters most here. Comey's firing nearly a year ago sparked questions of obstruction of justice by the president, led to the appointment of the special counsel. Here's Comey last night.
Was President Trump obstructing justice?
Possibly. I mean, it's certainly some evidence of obstruction of justice.
Do you think the Russians have something on Donald Trump?
I think it's possible. I don't know. These are more words I never thought I'd utter about a president of the United States, but it's possible. I would have been able to say with high confidence about any other president I dealt with, but I can't. It's possible.
Now, there's no doubt the publicity tour is helping sell books. It's also raising eyebrows and some legal questions. This is CNN contributor Mike Rogers. He's the former chairman of the House Intelligence Committee, also a former FBI agent.
To have the FBI director in the middle of an investigation even speculate that the president may have committed a crime he wasn't quite sure, I just thought really damages both his brand and the FBI brand. The fact that we now have two boys in the schoolyard calling each other names, I think is horrifically unproductive.
It's a similar conversation to the one we just had in the sense that some of this is playing out in the court of public opinion, and James Comey, like him or not, has decided he's going to join the insult factory and compete with the president to go back and forth insulting each other. Then there are the legal questions. George Stephanopoulos asking the question, did the president obstruct justice? Possible. Do the Russians have anything on the president? Possible. He, at least up to the point of when he was fired, he could answer more definitively. He's choosing not to. For what reason?
Well, I mean, I think selling books is a big motivation here. I mean, this is why he's out in public right now. But clearly he has jumped off of the sidelines and jumped out of the role of being a disinterested law enforcement person that he so proudly had for many decades and really jumped into the partisan fray here. And, you know, he could have given an interview and written a book that was much more kind of down the middle. But he clearly has a point of view, and he's taking sides, and he said some things about the president that were pretty petty, about like his hairdo and the size of his hands and his orange face with the, you know, tanning salon cups, potentially. So he definitely is coming from an angle, and it's possible that that damages his credibility with the public. I don't actually think it really changes the political calculus. There were, you know, Republicans, and particularly strong Trump supporters were going to think of him as evil and wrong anyway. And Democrats have mixed feelings about Jim Comey because of his role in the Clinton email matter. But in general, we're going to point to what he said in the book and what he says in the interview and say, you see, there's a law enforcement guy saying what we've all been saying about Donald Trump. So I don't think this really changes the political calculus much. But it does raise questions about, you know, why is he going quite so hard on some of the more petty personal matters.
And just for the record, Sarah Sanders, the president's on his way to Florida. We should see him land any minute. We'll show you that when it happens. Sarah Sanders, the press secretary, on the flight down. Did the president watch the Comey interview? She says he saw bits and pieces of it, didn't watch the whole thing. What was his reaction? Pretty similar. Didn't learn anything new, pretty much the same feelings. The president is pretty clear what those are, and the rest of the administration. The president has been pretty clear what those are. Tweeting again this morning, Comey drafted the crooked Hillary exoneration long before he talked to her, lied to Congress, then based his decisions on her poll numbers, disgruntled he, McCabe, and the others, committed many crimes. Factual, a lot of the president's tweets, factual errors, or he's leaping to conclusions we can prove. But these two have decided this is what we got right now. It makes great cable television, makes great Twitter. My question is more important to the Mueller investigation. Is Comey being careful enough here that he doesn't undermine himself as a witness? In the sense that if he says anything in these interviews that doesn't match up with what he told Mueller in the investigation, if the president has a good attorney, that's where the credibility question will matter. Let me put it that way. Not in this court of public opinion, but in a court of law.
No question, this is a big risk doing this publicity tour the way he's doing it, the books, the pot shots of the president, big risk for him, particularly his role in all this. But ultimately, despite all the noise, the ultimate questions are going to be those interactions that the president did have with James Comey, where he allegedly asked him for loyalty, where he allegedly asked him to back off the investigation into Michael Flynn, the fired national security advisor, someone who has now pleaded guilty about his conversations with Russians. What did he do in those conversations? And one thing that Comey did not say or did not know yesterday was whether or not the president knew that Flynn lied to the FBI at the time that he allegedly asked him to back off the investigation of Michael Flynn. Those are things that Mueller will ultimately have to investigate, and that's essential. That's the essence of what, despite all the noise, that's what where things will probably be.
An hour aired on ABC last night. They did 5 hours of the taping. You saw a sample at the top of the program of an interview with USA Today. There are many others, including he'll be on CNN with Jake Tapper later this week as well. So the question is this. This is Jack Shorman, who worked on the special counsel team in the Whitewater investigation. The book amounts to a new 300-page witness statement, and if it differs at all from what he provided to the special counsel, you can be sure there will be a challenge if this case moves to an impeachment or a trial. This will at least be a pain for Mueller to deal with, meaning there's somebody in the special counsel's office whose job it has just become hold up the transcript of your interviews with Comey, now match them up to everything he's saying as he tries to sell this book, then match them up to everything that's in the book and make sure there are no inconsistencies.
Well, undoubtedly, they're doing a lot of speed reading as they compare all of them. But I think also what we're seeing from Comey is he's making a bigger argument than just these meetings or the Russia probe. He's really making a sort of a moral case to the American public. I mean, he's going very big here, saying that this man isn't fit to be president, talking about the way he speaks about women, the way he treats people. And he also spoke looking ahead to the next election. He was asked, should he be impeached? And he said, no, he thinks the American people need to make a judgment here.
That's a fascinating point.
He's making a broad case.
It's a fascinating point because he, as a deputy attorney general in the Bush administration, as a Justice Department prosecutor before that, then as FBI director, his job was to stay out of politics. And he said, I hope not. When the impeachment question was, I said, I hope not that this should be settled in the next election, that the American people should vote on this. That, again, he's injecting himself into an area that he was paid to avoid and told to avoid for most of his career in public service.
And that's why I think a lot of this is interesting, and I'm going back to the political and public perception part of it, but if his goal is to sort of shore up the FBI's and law enforcement's reputation and his own as being a disinterested law enforcement officer, to shift from being that disinterested law enforcement officer to being an open partisan arguer and attack dog in some of these paragraphs, I'm not sure how that builds that case. It does sell you books, but I don't think if many people on the Trump side worry that a disinterested, powerful law enforcement officer is bound to become and act like a partisan attack dog in their role, then proving that maybe you were that is not a great look. And I'm somebody who was friendlier to Comey throughout this and saying he was served a bad plate here by the American people in our picks to run for president. But it's not good.
And then one of the debates is now that we know the president seeing all this Comey stuff, seeing the Cohen stuff going forward, and Rod Rosenstein's role in that, as well as the Mueller investigation, has all this ruminations, is the president going to fire somebody? Here's Jim Comey saying that would cross a line.
It would, I hope, set off alarm bells that this is his most serious attack yet on the rule of law. And it would be something that our entire country, again, Democrats and Republicans, that is higher than all the normal fights about policy. And it would be to the everlasting shame of partisans if they were unable to see that higher level and to protect it.
The question a lot of people who know the president ask is, you know, a lot of Republicans have given that advice in public and private to the president, don't go there. But if he sees Jim Comey giving it to him, might that provoke him, is a question people ask.
I think that's a fair question. I mean, you know, anything, pretty much anything that comes out of Jim Comey's mouth at this point, Trump is going to disagree with and make a show of disagreeing with. So, yeah, I think it's very possible that. But again, I think that the president's concerns with Rosenstein are, you know, well predate that comment, and he has wanted to and ruminated about going the next few steps to potentially dismissing Rosenstein long before this. So it might contribute, but I don't think it would be the only reason.
I think a bigger, the most immediate factor in that one will be this court hearing in the Cohen case this afternoon. Rosenstein approved that warrant. We'll see how that one plays out. A quick reminder for our viewers again, the former FBI Director James Comey will be right here at CNN to talk to Jake Tapper. That's Thursday, 4 p.m. Eastern. Remember, watch the interview right here on CNN. When we come back, the White House expected to hit Russia with new sanctions. Welcome back. The Trump administration, as early as today, plans to slap new sanctions on Russia, targeting businesses the White House says provide military equipment and financing to the Assad regime in Syria. A source telling CNN more than a dozen Russian entities are on a list being fine-tuned now at the Treasury Department. The sanctions follow the weekend airstrikes by U.S., British, French forces on sites linked to Syria's chemical weapons programs.
This is a very strained time between the United States and Russia. I mean, if you look at what Russia is doing, they continue to be involved with all the wrong actors. I mean, whether it's their involvement in Ukraine, whether you look at how they're supporting Maduro in Venezuela, whether you look in Syria and their way of propping up Assad and working with Iran, that continues to be a problem.
People asked after the strikes, what's the long-term strategy? You know, that the strikes send a message, but they don't solve the problem. This is part of it, more pressure on Russia, although there seemed to be a little bit of a, I don't want to call it slow walking, but the pause button at the White House today saying it might not be today. Nikki Haley seemed adamant it would be today. Then they seemed to say, well, we're not ready.
Right. Well, I think they're sorting through, how quickly they want to move and if they want to move, who are the actors they want to move against. But, you know, when the president said on Friday night, you know, that this was going to be a sustained effort, people sort of wondered, well, does that mean like more airstrikes, more military action and getting really deeply involved in a military way in Syria? And I think what the administration's trying to do is find other ways of messaging and signaling that they're serious about this. The question is sort of what is the overall policy? You know, even, strong advocates of the airstrikes on Friday said in its aftermath, airstrikes to, you know, as retaliation for a chemical weapons strike are not in and of themselves a policy. So what is going to be the policy? How is the administration going to sort of articulate that more broadly that just beyond, you know, the military action? Because clearly they're not willing to, you know, put on a sustained bombing campaign of Damascus. It doesn't seem like at this moment.
And that's why it seemed to be an unforced error when the president said over the weekend, mission accomplished. But what exactly is the mission? What exactly is the strategy? What is the ultimate end goal of the United States' involvement in Syria? That has not really been clearly explained, particularly by this president, who's been eager to pull back from Syria. Now, are we deepening our involvement there in the United States? What happens going forward? That's something that has not been clearly sort of disseminated by the administration.
To be clear, he said the next day that it was not an unforced error, that he meant to say mission accomplished, and he wants to bring the phrase back.
Wants to bring the phrase back.
That's right.
Is this not even a page turning? Is this book closed on the president's efforts to have a better relationship with Vladimir Putin? In the sense, the Washington Post writes, you know, Trump came to the White House believing his personal relationships with other leaders would be central to solving the world's thorniest foreign policy problems. In Trump's mind, no leader was more important or powerful than Putin. Privately, he complained to aides the media's fixation on the Mueller probe was hobbling his effort to woo Putin. I can't put on the charm, the president often said, according to one of his advisors. I'm not able to be president because of this witch hunt. Is the effort understandable to some degree to have at least a good working relationship with the leader of Russia, even if you have differences, they're big problems you need to talk to him about. Does this now, the president's own language Friday night about Russia's complicity with Assad, is it over or are we just in a new chapter?
I think this is one of the reasons, not the only reason. I think he also has a soft spot for strongmen. But one of the reasons that he doesn't say Putin specifically and he doesn't talk about that openly in real clear moral terms is because of this desire that he thought he could win him over and work with him. And so I think you will continue to have this dichotomy where, good, sanctions are good, strikes are good, you're being aggressive and you're making them pay for bad behavior, but you will not have the head of the administration really vocally and morally clear out there on that issue. And that's going to continue to be the situation. I will say, in this particular situation, you've got France being quite a bit more hawkish than I expected to see, which is nice. And I think you can have a happy medium here where you do some sanctions, where you do some strikes, you back up the red line. But the American public is not in the mood for a sustained on the ground, certainly, campaign here.
And to that point, forgive me for being a little snarky, but a lot of Republican members of Congress might be calling up the president of France. Emmanuel Macron says he's the one who convinced the president. The president had been very public about, I want to get out of Syria as soon as possible. I wish we were out yesterday. Now the U.S. troops are in a separate battle. They're not battling Assad, they're battling ISIS. But they're going to stay for at least 6 months, probably longer. Macron says he deserves the credit.
10 days ago, President Trump said the U.S.'s will is to disengage from Syria. We convinced him that it was necessary to stay. Please be reassured, we have convinced him that we had to stay on in the long term. The second thing is that we convinced him that we had to limit these strikes to chemical weapons, even though there had been a mediatic uproar by way of tweets, which you may have been aware of.
It's going to be an interesting state dinner coming up.
Here, Mr. President, here's the Comey transcript. Please don't read the Macron transcript.
Well, I mean, the White House is pushing back very hard against this. They're saying, Macron did not change the White House's position at all. You know, they've been very clear that this military operation was a U.S., U.K., French, joint operation. They're very proud of that. But, they're pushing back hard against the notion that Macron sort of convinced him that, it's in the U.S. interest to stay. The question really is, though, if we are going to, if the president's going to push so hard to get American troops out of the fight against ISIS in Syria, what does that mean for the broader strategy? So, I mean, I do think it raises a question for them, even if they're going to say that, no, in fact, it was not Macron who convinced him
just on the point of the broader strategy, one thing to look out for is that today, as soon as today, the Senate Foreign Relations Committee Chairman Bob Corker is going to release a new authorization for use of military force, something that has not been done in 16 years. Will there be bipartisan support, consensus, not just on Syria, but the broader war against terror? That's going to be an interesting debate going forward, whether it'll be the support, where the president and the White House ultimately come down, whether or not Congress should have a role in approving this new use of force, particularly if the United States continues to stay in Syria.
In an election year, of all things, too. I mean, it's not something not since just after 9/11 has the Congress debated this issue. A lot of Americans might be surprised to understand where there are U.S. military operations around the world. The question is, can the commander-in-chief do this all on his own? Should he have congressional authorizations? My view, they should at least vote. That's what they get elected for. They get elected to stand up for what the country's doing. Here's another question here, and any president, Donald Trump's the president right now, any president would be conflicted about what to do in Syria because there's no political solution on the table. You have a number of nefarious players involved that are going to be involved, Iran, Russia among them. This has caused a lot of tension in the relationship with Turkey. Here's Lindsey Graham, Republican senator, saying he understands the president has a conflict. He'd like him to be tougher.
If you're Assad, you heard a president saying, I'm going to make you pay a big price, you're an animal. And what did Assad see? A military strike that didn't change his life at all. So Assad wakes up the next day and goes back to work. If you're Russia and Iran, you heard our Pentagon, risk averse, deathly afraid of confronting the Russians. If you're ISIS, you heard we're going to leave. If you're the Kurds, you heard we're going to leave, which means they're going to get slaughtered. Lindsey Graham sees a very conflicted commander-in-chief.
Questions raised by a Republican senator there. Let's listen to the Republican president. He's in Florida. This is an event about tax cuts. We'll see if the president sticks to topic.
Our Secretary of the Treasury, he's right there, and our Secretary of Labor. Thank you, Alex. Thank you, Steve. Great choices. Not all of my choices were good, but they were great ones. Tomorrow's tax day, and we're going to hear from everybody and we have heard from so many people. They're so thrilled. And remember this is the last time you're going to fill up that long, complicated, horrible return. I would say that some of these companies that do all that work on getting a lot of money for doing your tax returns, they're not going to be too happy with us, but that's about the only business that won't be. So tomorrow, last day, very importantly, next year it's going to be a simple for the most part, one page. It may get a little bit bigger, but it'll be simple and easy to do. And very importantly, you're going to have a lot of money left over from what you have. And we didn't get one Democrat to vote for us. And Senator Nelson was hostile to it. And let me tell you, if for any reason they get in, meaning the Democrats, they're going to raise your taxes way up high. They're going to terminate this out. Of course, I'll veto it. That's all right. But eventually, they want to terminate and they want to raise your taxes. And we cannot let that happen because this country is starting to rock with our businesses coming back in. It's starting to really rock. So we've had massive tax cuts, and I mean massive. We've had tremendous success from the company standpoint and from the people standpoint. They're going out. They have a lot more money to spend. And, you know, something happened that we didn't even expect. Nobody talked about it. When we first had it passed, it started with, well, AT&T. We might as well give them credit. But they gave $1,000 bonuses to their employees, and that's a lot of employees. Then all of a sudden, other companies came along, and now you have all of the big, I mean, so many of the big companies, they've given bonuses to the people that work for the companies. That was unexpected. Nobody thought that was going to happen. And most importantly, we waited till February 1st, and you see what's happened to your wallet. I mean, you're getting a lot more money in your weekly or monthly checks than you ever thought possible. So people are really liking it, and very importantly, it's great for the country. Our taxes were the highest or among the highest, but just about, I would say, Marco, they were the highest in the world from a business standpoint. That's why businesses were leaving. Now, they're not the lowest, but they're on the low side, and businesses are pouring back into the United States, and that means jobs. That means jobs. So we've created, since Election Day, that beautiful, beautiful day. Was that a great day? Mario, we're saying we got a big, big percentage vote over here, didn't we? Huh? We got a big percentage vote. But since Election Day, we've created 3 million new jobs. 3 million. And people, if I would have said that prior to the election, that we'll create in a short period of time 3 million jobs, they would have said, that's ridiculous, that's an exaggeration, how can it be possible? We would have taken a lot of heat. But we've created 3 million new jobs, and now the number is even higher than that. So since Election Day, 3 million new jobs. Unemployment rates for Hispanics. Are there any Hispanics in the room? No, I don't. For Hispanics, we have the lowest level ever recorded. In other words, you have more employment. Now, think of it. Lowest level employment rates. For African Americans, the lowest level ever recorded. And I'm really proud of that. Unemployment for women, lowest level in 18 years. Women out there? So that means if you're a woman and Hispanic or a woman and African American, you're really doing well, right? That means you're really doing well. Remember when I used to say, that I used to take heat for it, what do you have to lose? I'd say, what do you have to lose? Every once in a while, I'd say, if it was a rambunctious stadium or something, I'd say, what the hell do you have to lose, right? And I get criticized by those people, the fake media back there. Fake media. No, I'd get criticized for using the word hell. I said, I've heard a heck of a lot worse than that. But the economy, Larry Kudlow's here someplace. Where's Larry? Larry Kudlow. Where's Larry? Come on, Larry, stand up. He just gave me a number. He said the economy is entering the greatest boom in many decades. In other words, it's now at the early phase, would you say that, Larry? Of the earliest and greatest. This could be one of the greatest booms ever. I think it will be, actually, because the companies are so strong and they're ready to rock. What do you think, Larry? Good, I thought you were going to say that. Could you imagine if he didn't? Could you imagine if he said, no, I disagree with that? Right. Everybody's going to benefit, he said. That's right. And very importantly, and by the way, John Bolton is here, and we just had a big, successful hit. John. So I think